house. Amen. Let's stand up and let's sing, "This is the day."
This is a day, this is a day that the Lord had made, that the Lord had made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord had made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day.
Now, that's pretty good. That is pretty good. But I think we can do just a little bit better. So let's sing it one more time.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day.
Let's continue our song service with one that, I don't know, there's a little old church up there on a hill somewhere in Trustful that just loves this song. It's called Victory in Jesus. How many of you got Victory in Jesus this morning?
Amen.
I have Victory in Jesus. Let's sing it.
How a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame walk again and cause the blind to see. And then I cried, "Dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit." And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
My favorite verse here.
I heard about a mansion He's built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. I am about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He pledged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
That's some great singing. Boy, y'all are doing great this morning. Let's continue along with our song service with Standing on the Promises. Thank you.
standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ my King. Bound eternally by love's strong cord. Overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Trusting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior.
Amen. You may be seated. Yeah, you can sit for a second. We got one more song, preacher, and I'll turn it over to you.
Since he let y'all sit down, I'll let you catch your breath.
Thank you.
I'll give a couple of announcements while y'all catch your breath. It's good to see all of you this morning. Amen. Glad you're here today in church. Man, it's already hard to believe that January is almost over. Before you know it, it'll be Christmas again. Anyway, out front, you probably noticed there's boxes and baskets and all kind of different stuff scattered around. The box is out there for your Christmas card fronts. Putting all your Christmas stuff up, cut the front off your card, the part they signed and all, keep it, throw it away. But the fronts they reuse for the shoe boxes every year. So that box is out there so you can bring those card fronts. Your giving statements for last year are out at the Welcome Center. Make sure you get those. And then there's some cards in the basket out there. You can pick up one of those if you'd like to write something in it. Some have some in them, some are blank, but just a note of encouragement for Miss Brenda. So there's some cards available out there for you to do that with if you want to pick one of those up. And then I won't be preaching about it today, but don't forget that today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. It's the day that, you know, we focus the Sunday that has been set aside to focus on, you know, the ungodly, wicked murder of unborn babies. And it's one of those things I try not to talk too much about it because I'd liable to say something in a way I shouldn't say it. But
yep.
It's it is what it is, and it's wrong. It's against God's word, and we know that we stand against that. And we do our best to support the efforts of anything we can that would overturn that legislation. And that's what God's called us to do, stand for truth stand up for truth and support those that do that. So just don't forget that. Pray for folks that may have, you know, might have had a bad situation in life and have experienced that. You know, God's grace is still there. And God's still in the forgiving business, the saving business, and He still loves people. So just remember that. And we should always do that. When we make a stand on something, we always stand for truth and right, but we never forget that God loves sinners and we're to love them and extend grace and mercy that way too. So anyway, don't forget about that. And pray for the choir as they sing and bring this last song to us before we have the message. All right?
Found this song that was in this book. It's called Word of God Speak. Anybody ever heard of it? Okay. It's a Mercy Me song. Does anybody know who Mercy Me is? Okay, so there's a few of us that know who Mercy Me is. All right. It's an older song, and it's a song that kind of caught my attention. The pastor's been talking about relationships with God. You know, the best way you can have a relationship with anybody is if you listen to what they have to say. I mean, you listen to them and you talk to them about what you want to talk about, and you know, then you have a relationship. And that's what this song is about. It's about cutting out the noise in the background that's going on everywhere around you and just kind of listen to what God has to say. So the name of the song is called Word of God Speak.
Stay.
Amen. Well, that should be our desire every time we come. It's mine for the Word of God to speak, because I don't have much good to say. But the Lord does, and that's what matters most of all. So if you have your copy, we'll let the Lord's Word speak to us today from Ephesians chapter number 1. Ephesians chapter number 1. Thank you, choir, for the song. It was wonderful. They get better and better each week. We just need to get more of them. Maybe some of y'all can join them. So, and if you're watching online, you come join the choir. We'll let you come and join the choir too. So we appreciate all the folks that watch online, those that listen on the radio. Thank you for watching and being a part, listening of our service. Ephesians chapter number 1, you can just hold your place right there, and we'll get there in just a moment. Last year, it was about this time, mid-January, 1st of February, we looked in the book of Acts, chapter 20, and verse number 20. And I brought a message about a 2020 vision or a 2040 vision. You know, where we would be as a church. And where we wanted to go as a church. Because I didn't come here to plan on staying a year or two and then leaving or getting run off. I came to be here for the long haul. And, you know, that's what we ought to do as God's people, plan for the future. Somebody said, work like you'll live forever and live like you'll die tomorrow. I think that's a good philosophy. And so we have to plan. We have to think ahead. We have to prepare for the future. We looked at these verses here. It's actually Paul was not in Ephesus. He had been at Melita. And he calls the elders from the churches in Ephesus. He calls them to come and meet with him before he has to get on a ship to travel again. He didn't have time to go to them, so he called them to come to him because he knew this would probably be the last time he would get to see them personally and address them as the elders of the churches there in Ephesus. And we looked in verse 20, and he said there, it starts at about verse 17, and I'm just going to read a few of these verses just to kind of rehearse. We won't preach the message over, but he says in verse 20, just go back to verse 19, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befall me by the lying in wait of the Jews. He's explaining to them where he is in life and what his next steps are. How I kept nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. When he says in verse 20, I kept back nothing, that didn't mean, don't get in your head like it was a tell-all situation. Bless God, I just told it all. That's not what he means. The Greek word there, it means that he set a full table. It has Luke's writing this. All right, Luke's giving the record of all these things. And that's from his doctrine terminology and the way he writes. He just means that he put out a full table of food. When it says, I held nothing back. I gave you all that there was to eat. I put it all out there for you. That's what he's expressing there. And then in verse 21, he says, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. He takes the whole gospel and puts it just into one little nutshell. That this is what is more important than anything else. that you have repentance toward God. God, I've wronged you. You're the God of the universe. You are the creator. You established all this. You made it all. It all belongs to you, and I've wronged you. Amen. We grow up sometimes thinking that God owes us something. And God doesn't owe us anything but hell. It's because of His mercy we don't have to go there. And it's because of His grace He gives us another place that's better than there to go. That'll sink in one day and you'll run and shout about two laps around the house. That you don't have to go to hell, but you get to go to heaven. God owes us nothing. But when we come to Him in repentance, God, You're right and I'm wrong. Nothing about me is right. Not one iota of me is right. On my best day as a Christian, I'm wrong. On my best day as a pastor, I'm wrong. On my best day of anything, my righteousness, the Bible says, is as filthy rags. I have nothing to offer God but just a rotten, old, dirty shell of a fleshly human being. But when the Spirit of God fills people like that, it shows the work of God. Repentance. When we admit that we can be wrong before God and that He's right, and we turn to Him, the Bible says, in faith. In faith. Well, that's a big word. Means a whole lot. We kick it around real lightly sometimes, but it's a very deep word. And it has a whole lot of meaning to it. And sometimes we don't take it as serious as we ought to. But He says, He gives the whole gospel right there. You got to repent, number one. And you got to believe, number two. There's a lot of people believe but never repent. And there's a lot of people that repent but they never believe. And you got to have both. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. He gives all that right there. And they know what He's talking about. They know that He's cutting to the chase. He's being serious. Time is short. I got to get these things out to you because you got to go and I got to go. He says here, and now behold, I go bound the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. Well, that's a bold statement. It's a very bold statement in verse 26. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which He hath purchased with His own blood. For I know this, that after my departure shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Paul, he challenges these leaders from the church at Ephesus, and he gives them some things here, and I'm not going to preach them, but let me just point them out. I talked about, he said, I put it all out here on the table for you. Give you everything you need, fill you up right out here on the table. Number one, repentance and faith. The message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in verse 24, he says, I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. So we have the gospel of salvation. And then he reiterates here in verse 24, the grace of God. And then in verse 25, he says, and I talked to you and told you about the kingdom of God, that which is to come, the kingdom of God. And then in verse 27, he said, I've not shunned to declare unto you the counsel of God, the whole of the principles of God's word, the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation. Paul said, I've given you everything that you need. Now go back and do something with it, because when I leave, when I'm gone, there's going to come a time when people, remember what he wrote to himself, wrote to Timothy, there'll be a time when people will come and they won't believe the truth. They'll heap unto themselves teachers having itching ears. They just want to hear what they want to hear. They don't want to hear the truth. So Paul's encouraging these men. There's going to come that time. There'll be grievous wolves that'll come in, and they won't spare the flock. They'll wreak havoc in the flock. You ever seen, have you ever had the privilege to see what a hog can do to a piece of land? Maybe somebody around you had some pigs or something, and they kept them in a pen out in the back. Or maybe you've been able to be out in the woods, hunt or somewhere, bound where some wild hogs has been. I'm going to tell you, when a hog gets through with a piece of ground, it looks like somebody went through there with a John Deere and a big old tiller on the back of it. I mean, you talk about no stone left unturned. I mean, they dig up every blade of grass, every root. They just leave it as a wasteland. Well, that's exactly what Paul's talking about here when he says they're not sparing the flock. When they wreak havoc among you, he said in another place. That's what it means. There'll be people come in and try to do that kind of stuff. And he said, some of them will be your own people that'll do that. In verse 30, he said, but watch and remember. I cease not to warn you night and day. Don't forget what I've taught you. Don't forget what I've told you. So he encourages them to go on. You say, well, what's that have to do with anything? This is about the church at Ephesus. And I've been reading on it and studying on it for a little while. Had conversation not too long ago with somebody else, told me they was reading through the epistle there that Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus. But this occasion here, or the message from last year about our vision and about moving forward and about what we feel like the Lord wants us to do, that's where that came from when he spoke to those elders there in the church at Ephesus. So I've been going back over that and studying more about the church at Ephesus there. And for the next few weeks, we're going to look at that church and see what Scripture teaches us about that church, what we can learn from that church, because we want to fulfill that vision. We want to be able to go forward for the Lord if the Lord leaves us here long enough to do it. Ephesians chapter number 1 in verse 1, the Bible says this, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now, we're not at Ephesus, are we? We're not the saints that are at Ephesus. We didn't live then, and that's not what we call this little hill that our church sits on. It's not Ephesus, it's Trustful. But notice right there what he says. He says, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. We could be considered the faithful in Christ Jesus. So that's what I want to speak about for just a few minutes this morning. The faithful. The faithful. I believe that God's Word teaches us that there are principles that we live by. There are principles we go by. And they're everything in God's Word is important. But he sets it kind of in stages or you know, maybe like in an outline. God, he likes organization. And so he'll group things and he'll put things together. And, you know, this is pretty important here. And this is not unimportant, but this might be a little more important. You understand what I'm saying? There's big things, little things. And it's all through Scripture. I believe there's three things that moving forward, that is we go forward as a church. I believe there's three things that God's Word teaches us, and we can find them as we start out here when he talks about the faithful in Christ Jesus. We can start right there. There's three things that are important and that the church should emphasize. And the first of those things is faith. Faith. Faith is the cornerstone of life. Faith is not something that you just have. It is the key. It's the cornerstone of life. Here's the definition of the word faith: to believe, to obey, to draw towards. You believe something, you obey what you believe, and you draw towards what you believe. Faith. All right? So when we think of it that way, that's a big thing, isn't it? It goes beyond sometimes just our little scope of what we think faith really is. It's easy to illustrate faith. We've done that before. You had faith when you came in here. None of you did a mathematical study on whether or not the wood in that pew was strong enough or sturdy enough to hold up your body. You just flopped down on it. You know why you did that? Because you had faith it would hold you up. You believed it would hold you up. So in obedience to your mind, you sat down. Without none of you reached back there and pushed to see if it was going to be sturdy. You just in simple obedience to your instinct of that faith in that bench, you sat down on it. You drew near to it. You understand? I mean, it can be that simple, but God wants us to have faith in Him. He wants us to have faith in this book. And we have to live our life. But four times in Scripture, God says the just, people that will be justified, people that will live righteously, God's people, the just shall live by faith. Now, if God says something one time, it's important. But if He says the same thing, exactly the same way, four different times, in four different eras of time in Scripture, I believe God's emphasizing something. And that means that His people will always be a people of faith. Amen. We don't walk by sight. We walk by faith. And it's not my faith that I walk by. Paul said, I don't live this life by my faith. He said, I live it by the faith it's the faith of the Son of God. Let me just read it. Sometimes they all run together. Galatians, about two pages or so back. Galatians 2, verse number 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live, listen, by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. Paul said, it's not my faith that I live by. I live by faith, but my faith is in the Son of God. It's His faith. The faith that I get excited sometimes and I can't even get it all out. It's the faith that Jesus Christ had when He, on that cross, dying for my sin, dying for your sin, He said, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Jesus said, I'll give it up. It's all up. God, it's up to you now. I've done everything I could do. I hung here in the blackness of darkness and bore the sins of the world while you turned your back on me. And now I'm going to bow my head in this final act. And I'm going to physically die. And I've got faith in you that you'll put the life of the Spirit back in me. And 3 days later, I'll come out of that tomb. I'm talking about faith. The faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. He had faith in his own self that his Father would, by the Holy Spirit of God, would raise the Son of God back to life. And on that third day, he walked out, and he didn't move the stone. He just walked right on by the stone without even pushing it. It was the people that moved the stone. Faith. That's the kind of faith that God wants us to have. The church needs faith. It's the cornerstone of life. Our journey, I got to move on. Our journey of life begins with faith. You think, well, I've always been a person of faith. Well, really, you haven't. You haven't. Because the Bible says right here in Ephesians 2, if you're back there in Ephesians 1, look over at chapter 2. And you hath he quickened who were what? Dead. You were born into this world a living, breathing human being, but the Bible says that you were born dead in trespasses and sins. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. And we could go on and lay it out there. In verse 4, but God, he comes along with his mercy there in verse 5. He's quickened us in verse 5. And he says that by grace you're saved. And then you go on down, and there it is in verse 8 and 9. By grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. What's not of yourselves? The grace or the faith? The faith. The grace is God's. We don't know nothing about grace. Grace is God's. It's his faith that he gives us to believe and accept the grace that he's giving us. You understand? By grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It's not of my own faith. If he didn't prove himself to me, how could I believe in him? You believe things you don't prove? You sat on that pew, didn't you? Simple acts of faith. How do we learn those things? How does a little child learn to put his faith in Jesus Christ? The easiest way is because he or she watches mama and daddy do it. And you and I come to a saving faith because somebody lived a way in front of us that expressed or showed that faith to us. We saw it in the life of someone else. And God used that to draw us to faith in him. You see? It's all the work of God in our life. So the journey of life then, that statement is a true statement. It begins with faith. You can't even say you're living until you have faith. And that faith must be in the Son of God, in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we're born dead in our trespasses and sin. And so if we accept Christ and we're born again by faith in him, then we have this new life and we're to live by our faith. That's what God commands us in his word. Faith is important. So what's important at church? What do we focus on at church? We focus on people's faith. Number one, do you have saving faith? Are you saved by the grace of God? Do you believe? Do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and him alone for your salvation? Amen. It's not about religion, not about denomination, not about baptism, not about catechism, not about anything. It's about faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. What did Paul say? Repentance and faith. Repentance and faith. The gospel message. So we emphasize faith. And not just that we have saving faith, but we talked about it a few weeks ago that we add to our faith. Most people get faith and they stop right there. Well, I got saved. I'm going to heaven. That's all I need. Well, that's all you need to get there. It's an awful long, boring journey. And you ain't going to be real happy when you get there because you ain't going to have nothing when you get there. If you don't live a life of faith. So then we emphasize our faith, that our faith grows. Our faith is tested. Our faith becomes stronger. Our faith gets bigger. Peter said, add to your faith. And he gives seven or eight things there that we're to add to our faith. That's how we grow as Christians. So number one, we emphasize faith at the church. We want to be a church that emphasizes faith and living by faith and growing in our faith. And then the second thing this morning we learn about the faithful is that this, we don't just live by faith, but we are a family of faith. A family of faith. Why is family important? Why do we emphasize family? Family is the catalyst of life. It is the catalyst of life. The definition of family is this: descendants of one common progenitor. Originator, if you don't like that word. One common progenitor or an originator. Look in verse 1 of Ephesians 1. Which are at Ephesus to the faithful in Christ Jesus. If we're saved, if we have faith, then we are in Christ Jesus. We become part of the family of God. In verse 2, he said that you have blessed, you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. How? In Christ. In Christ. So he's that, we're descendants of that one common thing. To the Jew, what are they descendants of? Who is the father of the Jewish people? Father Abraham. Father Abraham, he's the originator. God started the Jewish nation with Abraham. Family is important to God. God's the one that established the family. God created this earth, put all these things in it. He put a man out there in the midst of the garden. And he said, you know what? He said, I don't like it that you're alone. He said, I'm going to give you somebody to be there with you. And he put Eve there with him. And they were in the garden. He said, now you have dominion over all this. And you need to fill this place up with people. And so we know sin came, all that stuff. But they got busy doing what God told them to do. That was what? That was called family. Mom and dad. Family. That's what family is. You know, people say, well, my mama's side, my daddy's side. You know, Cain and Abel, they didn't have a mama's side and a daddy's side. The Bible says, and they too became what? One flesh. Adam and Eve became one flesh. You know what the problem is? See, this is how subtle the devil is. It's how slick he is. When I was a kid growing up, it's just happened in my lifetime. Now, women, I'm for you. So don't let anything I'm about to say make you think I'm not for you. Because I'm for you. But here's what happened in my lifetime. When I was a kid, and when you were children growing up, when a young girl married a husband, she took his name, but her last name did not become her middle name. Don't get mad at me. But you understand what I'm saying? Because you remember this. When you got married, you became whatever he was. My wife was Wilden. When she married me, she became Jennings. And 50, 60, 70 years ago, that's all she would have ever been, was Jennings. Somewhere in there, I don't know because I was a kid. But somewhere in there, somehow we decided somewhere that women would just say, well, now I'm Mrs. Wilden Jennings. Put a little dash in there. Didn't want to lose their identity. I don't know. I don't know why they made that rule. I don't know why they changed that. But I'm telling you this, you started division. Now it's him and her. This whole thing about divorce, his and hers, mine and yours and his. And God said they shall be what? One flesh. And you can't separate one. It's just one. And one, do my kids have Wilden traits in them? Sure they do. Do they have Jennings traits in them? Sure they do. And it's not because they're all three boys, but they will always be Jennings. My wife will always be Wilden, no matter what her last name is, but she's not promoting Wilden anymore because she one day became Jennings and we became one. That's what family is. One. You come from one. Do you understand where I'm going? One. And the devil's kindly helped us separate that. And we didn't even realize what he done. Now I'm not, if you keep your name, I'm not against you and you do what you want to do. I'm not mad at you. And I'm not telling you you're unbiblical or anything like that. I'm just trying to prove a point to you. That's how slick the devil is, and that's how he can work something in and we don't even know he's done it. And he creates division. That's how he does it. But it's that original, that one. So God established the family. He made it, and he gave us family ever since the beginning. So family is important to God. And the church ought to emphasize family. We live in a world that wants to do everything it can to destroy and dismantle the family. Do you realize just in your generation, in your lifetime, they got this thing called children's rights? Don't you wish they'd have had that when your dad had you out behind the barn somewhere? Where was your rights at? Would you be advocating for that today? Who do you want to raise your children or your grandchildren? Do you want to raise them and influence them from God's word, or you want the government to do it? You want somebody else to do it. See? Family is important. And God gave us family. And he gave us responsibilities in the family. And I don't have time to preach about the family this morning. Other than the fact that church emphasizes family. And this church needs to emphasize family. Not just do we have an earthly heritage, but we have a spiritual heritage. And here's how strong it is in the Word of God. In the book of Acts, on more than one occasion, a man got saved. And you'll read a verse or two later, and then you'll read these words, and his household. Amen. Read the book of Acts. Look in Acts chapter 16. That's one I can just pop right off the top of my head. Acts chapter 16. And that jailer, he got saved. And they went to his house, and as soon as daddy got home with them apostles and they sat down at meat, you know what? The rest of the family got saved. Amen. The Bible says, and his household. There is a such thing as household salvation, where your family can know for sure that everybody in the household is on their way to heaven one day. But it's got to start out with a daddy that's got enough backbone to walk with God and live with God and teach God in the household. Men would stand up and be men in this country, our nation would be different. We can't blame it on Hollywood. We can't blame it on anybody else. It's the men of this country that have got weak-kneed, spineless backbones, and we've just gotten weak on the things of God. And we don't lead at home. Afraid of making somebody mad. Afraid of hurting somebody's feelings. I don't understand it. And then we sit and wonder why the nation's in the mess it's in. Family is important. It starts out with good godly men leading in their home. I'll say this and then we're moving off of family. No church is ever, it's never ever more than what the families in the church are. It'll never be better. It'll never be more spiritual. It'll never be more anything than what the families that make it up are. That's why family is important in a church. And then thirdly this morning, it Talking about the faithful at Ephesus, the faithful. Faith is the cornerstone of life. Family is the catalyst of life. We must be born into the family of God, and then our families can have salvation, and then as our spiritual heritage goes, then we can be a family of faith together. Then fellowship. Three important things in any church: our faith, our families, and our fellowship. Fellowship is not just getting together and having a piece of pie and a cup of coffee. Now, we've reduced it to that because that's easy. But that's not what the fellowship in the book of Acts is. It's not what the fellowship of the church was in the book of Acts. Fellowship is the comfort of life. Here's the definition: mutual association of persons on equal and friendly terms. And it's a key ingredient to a successful church, and it has been ever since the church started in the book of Acts. It's all through the book of Acts. It's in these letters that were written by the different apostles to the churches. Fellowship is a key element. To be a people of faith and to have that family feeling and that functionality, the fellowship part is key. When we fellowship together, here's what a people of faith do. This is what their fellowship is. When they fellowship, they learn together the principles of God's Word. We learn together the principles of God's Word. Then we labor together in the work of the gospel. We labor together in the work of the gospel. That's our fellowship, that we learn, that we labor, that we love each other and those lost folks who Christ also loved. That we love each other and that we love the lost. Christ died for everybody, and we ought to love everybody just like He did. So then we learn to lean on each other through the difficulties of life. So a fellowship, a group of people, remember the definition, a group of people that have a mutual association on equal and friendly terms. What are we mutually associating for? We're a fellowship of faith. We're a family of faith. We're a people of faith. And in that, we learn together, we labor together, we love each other, and we lean on each other. That's what the fellowship of the body is. From Acts 2 all the way through chapter 28, you'll find that that's what their fellowship was. To learn the principles of God's Word together, to work together to propagate or expand, promote, practice, preach, teach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to love each other and to love the lost, and to lean on each other in difficult times. That's what a fellowship of believers does. So really, if you think about it, just like Paul gathered those Ephesian pastors, if you will, together that day and gave them that charge, he summed it all up. He broke it down into the simplest thing. And this morning, as the pastor, you know, the president gives the State of the Union every year, tell you how we're doing in our nation. And I'm not going to give a state of the church message, but if I was, this might be it. That at this point and moving forward and what we established last year, and you know, COVID came along and it disrupted our year. It disrupted what we do and what we wanted to do and how we wanted to do things. But you know what? We can put that behind us. It doesn't have to govern our life forever. It's something we have to live with, but it doesn't have to rule us. Why? Because we got a God that's bigger. I've said that all along. We've got a God that's bigger. When we place our faith in Him, our trust in Him, then he'll guide us. He'll lead us where he wants us to be. So as we try to continue to move forward and do the things that I believe that the Bible teaches us and I believe that God wants us to do, then there's three things that we need to learn to emphasize at church so that our friends in this community, our folks that may not have been in a while, they want to know and understand what is Sulphur Springs Baptist Church and what makes Sulphur Springs Baptist Church and why should that be the church that I want to go and be a part of and minister at and serve in and get my faith food from? Why should it be a part? I'll tell you why. Because we emphasize faith. Amen. We're a church of faith. We've seen God do things, and we want to see God do more things. Because it's not about what I can do or what you can do. It's about what God can do. Moses did not part the Red Sea. He just stood there with his arms up and God parted the Red Sea. So some of us have to stand with our arms up by faith and see what God can do. We want the world to know that we emphasize faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the cornerstone of life. We want people to know that we're big on family at Sulphur Springs. Well, you don't have this, you don't have that, and you know what? If God wants us to have those things, we'll have those things. But we won't have them until the world knows that we love families and that we love them, whatever their situation is, whether it's single parents or two parents or mixed blends or what. There's so many kinds of different families out there nowadays, you can't even put them all under a label. But you know what? It don't matter what label they're under. We just love families. We just love people. And if you don't have a family, we love you and you can be a part of our family. We bought a bus out there so we could pick up kids. And it doesn't matter if they're kids or they're adults. We just bought a bus so we could go pick people up that maybe didn't have a family, didn't have some, so we could bring them and they could come and be a part of our family. You see? We just need somebody to go visit a few folks and see if they want to ride and then we'll go get them. Family is important. And loving on families is important. And then fellowship. Fellowship. Fellowship is not cake and ice cream. Fellowship is learning together, laboring together, loving each other and the lost, and leaning on each other through difficult times. That's the fellowship of a believer. We want people to, there's people out there maybe watching on the internet, listening on the radio. Maybe you have some friends you could go home and talk to this week. They used to be in church at one time. And they got out of church. You know why they got out of church? Somebody in church hurt their feelings. Church is the easiest place to get your feelings hurt. Church is the easiest place in the world to get mad at. Church is the easiest place in the world to sin in. And I mean, just live all kind of crazy ways. Because the devil wants that. He makes it easy for it to happen. But you know what you need to do? You need to go to them people that have been disgruntled by the church and been hurt in the church because of the church. And usually it's people in the church. You need to go to those folks and tell them, you know what? We're working real hard for our church not to be that kind of church. We want it to be a place where people can fellowship together in the service of God. Where He's first in what we do. And He's foremost in what we do. And personalities and attitudes and my desires and this and that. Where those things don't get in the way of the fellowship of the believer. Where we learn, we love, we lean, we labor, we do all those things together. And that there might be a place for them here to serve because we just love people. So, in 2021, may God help us to be that kind of people. A people of a personal faith so that we can come together as a family of faith to serve the Lord in a fellowship of faith. The world's just looking for something real. It is. And I'll tell you this, I've watched for years, and we'll get into this in some of the coming messages. This is not the end. This is the beginning of Ephesians and what we're going to learn about the church of Ephesus. I can tell you this, from all the years of studying and watching and observing, all the programs and all the marketing, none of that lasts. None of that lasts. If you want a church that grows, and you want a church that becomes what God wants it to be, it's got to be a healthy church. That's what it takes. We don't need a new program. We don't need a new scheme. We don't need a new marketing tool. We do need our website back online. I don't know what happened to it. Jim told me this morning that he discovered our website's not online anymore. So we got to get that figured out and get it, you know, back on there. But we want to be something for God. We want people to know that we're here. They can find a place that's real. So it's not about all the new schemes or techniques. It's just about real. Because that's what people are looking for. Something that's real. Something that's genuine. Because I hear people come to me all the time. Well, you know, we tried this church and we tried that church. And you know, it's just not. And I'm not knocking them. Not knocking them. I'm just saying there's just something different about certain churches that decide they just want to be real. They just want to be real. I want to be real. I told you a few weeks ago, I ain't backing up. I ain't apologizing. I want to thrive till the Lord calls me home. I don't want to go in coasting on survival mode. I want to thrive. And the church will not make it on survival mode. It won't make it. We've got to decide that we want to thrive and live for the Lord Jesus Christ. And be real for Him. Let's bow our heads. Father, we're so thankful that we have this place to come to. God, we're thankful for those that paved the way before us. God, I thank you that I didn't grow up in cold, dead churches. God, I didn't have to go sit under preachers and just read a few verses and read a commentary. God, I'm thankful that I grew up under men that spent time with you. They preached the whole counsel of God. God, I don't understand why you would even call somebody like me. Allow me, Lord, to stand and open your word before people. But God, I know that you're still alive. You are still in charge. Heaven's gates haven't been shaken. Foundations lie sure of your word, the principles and the teachings that you give us in it. God, though our nation may be crumbling all around us, the foundation of the church stands sure because it's built on the cornerstone of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, I will build my church. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. God, sometimes it feels like we're sitting right against the gate. Lord, we're just right outside the gate of hell. It's all around us. God, help us to stand on the foundation of faith. God, help us to emphasize the foundation of homes and families in a generation that puts no premium on home,
puts no premium on life at all. Millions and millions of unborn babies murdered every year. God, help us to emphasize family, the importance of what it means to have a home. If it's a single parent home or a blended home, it doesn't matter all those things, but God, it's somebody's home. We want to help them to have a strong home and to be a family that knows you, have a spiritual heritage they can pass on to their children and to their children's children. God, help us to be big in fellowship, the fellowship of learning your word together, the fellowship of living your word, loving others, laboring for the sake of the gospel. Lord, the fellowship of leaning on each other. Times get tough. God, help us to be that kind of church. Help us to be a church in this new year. God, as we're still living in uncharted waters, in unsettled times, that God, people that live in this community, people that we work with day in and day out, people that we fellowship with if we're retired or whatever it may be, people that we fellowship with, God, help them to see Jesus in us. Help us to witness to them and testify to them that there's a place they can come and be a part of that's real, that's in love with Jesus, wants to see other people saved, wants to do what we can do to carry the gospel into all the world. God, help us to be focused on those things. Help us, Lord, to thrive in the days ahead. Teach us as we venture off into this study, the church at Ephesus. God, their strengths and their weaknesses. And help us to become a healthy church so that we can grow as you see fit. And we'll give you praise and glory for everything that you do. The mighty name of Jesus, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you.